Hello, good morning everyone, and welcome to this online media workshop on renewable energy in Maharashtra. We're very glad that colleagues have joined us, and we have a great panel for you of people who will tell us about the prospects, the promises, the problems, how to overcome the problems of pushing renewable energy in Maharashtra more and more all the time. And I'm not going to take much time now at this stage to give a huge introduction to what we are going to do. As you know, our panelists are Vibhuti Garg from IEEFA, Shantanu Dixit from Prayas, Ulka Kelkar from WRI India, and Vandana Gombar from Bloomberg New Energy Finance. So before that, I thought it would be helpful if we just refreshed our memories through one or two slides. So I requested my colleague Sapna Gopal from India Climate Dialogue to just tell us how many megawatts of solar and wind are there installed in Maharashtra today, how many megawatts are planned, how many megawatts are being constructed. Just that basic background information with which we can start working. After the panelists have spoken, I'm going to share with you a story grant opportunity, because this is part of what we do in the Internews Earth Journalism Network, as you know very well, that we try to help journalists who want to do stories on environmental issues, on renewable energy, or on related issues, and who may need some kind of help through story grants. So there is a call for story grants out. So we would want you to send proposals in. The last date is 15th of December. I'll share a few details and the link to it after the panelists have spoken. Sapna, over to you to give us the background.
Thank you, Joydeep. Good morning, everybody. And can everyone see this?
Not yet.
One second. This is not coming. One second, please. It was working finally.
Not a problem.
Just give me a... Now is it visible? Is it visible? Oh.
Yeah, it is visible. You have to just do a full screen, that's all.
You just go full screen, that's it, it's visible.
Okay, this is my full screen here. I don't know why it's not
coming. What you have to do is that, you know, at the bottom right of your screen, there is that thing that looks like a slide. Show. Just left of where your mouse is. Just left of that, immediately left of that. Just okay. Click on that and you'll get full screen.
Not getting it, Jyoti.
All right.
Go to slideshow mode, yeah. Just on the right side, second click.
Next one. Yeah. No, two after that. No, the next one. Next one. Yeah. That's it.
Yeah.
That's it. Okay. Let's move to the next slide.
Sorry about this delay. Okay, so we are discussing renewable energy Maharashtra, prospects, problems, and some of the ways to overcome them. And this is an overview of Maharashtra and of the various cities and districts, just to give everybody an idea. And quickly going through, Maharashtra is the third largest state geographically and the second most populous state in India. It has the most business enterprises and employment opportunities compared to other states. And interestingly, renewable energy has a 15% share of the total electricity generated generation capacity of the state. So renewable energy is definitely, is there in Maharashtra and is going in a big way. And this is the renewable energy source target which Maharashtra has kept for itself by the year 2022. So this is solar. This is all in megawatts. This is wind. And there is also biomass and mini hydel. But we will be talking more about solar and wind today. And coming to solar power, Maharashtra is one of the three best regions in India for solar installations. And reportedly there are about 250 to 300 clear sunny days. And there's irradiation of, So there is a lot of potential for solar power in Maharashtra. And it can produce, the numbers are there. Can everybody see the numbers, please, over here? 1.5 million units.
Yes.
Can people see the numbers here, please?
Okay. Yes.
So there's potential in terms of solar photovoltaic systems, which is PV systems, through solar thermal systems, and also through rooftop solar. And there are six solar cities which are in Maharashtra. So there's Nagpur, there's Kalyan, Dombivli, there's Shirdi, there's Thane, there's Nanded, there's Pune. And out of these cities, Nagpur has been declared as a major solar city. Shirdi and Thane are pilot solar cities. And then there are these major solar parks in Maharashtra also, which are on the anvil. So a lot of solar potential is there in Maharashtra. Then this is the energy mix. RES stands for Renewable Energy Sources. So interestingly, while coal has a majority still, but then there's renewable energy resources also, which are sources which are also taking up quite a bit of the portion here. I mean, quite a huge chunk is being occupied with renewable energy sources, which means there's a lot of potential for solar, there's potential for wind, and also small hydro also. Which was restricted to the northeast and some parts of North India. But interestingly, Maharashtra is one state, unlike the south, it has got a lot of potential for small hydropower in India, which apparently is not being spoken about much. So there's potential there also. So there's a lot of energy mix wise, it also looks pretty balanced for the now. And this is wind energy. And this figure that I have got, that the total installed capacity of wind in Maharashtra, according to the Maharashtra Energy Development Agency, as per 2019-20, is 7,575 megawatts. So that is the total installed capacity of wind, despite all the issues that the developers have been facing. But solar and wind has been doing really well in Maharashtra. So that is encouraging news for the state and for renewable energy. So these are the producers which have been enrolled with MEDA, Maharashtra Energy Development Agency, MEDA, as it's known, for wind projects. And then there were 339 stations which were selected for this category with 40 sites in Maharashtra. I think the figures may have gone up a little more, but these are the figures which were available to me. So this is the status of wind energy in Maharashtra. So that's about it from me, Joydeep. These are the figures and facts about solar and wind in Maharashtra. Hello.
Over to you, Joydeep.
Yes, thank you very much, Sapna. So everybody, that's the basic background. Sapna will stop sharing her screen now so that we can move to the first panelist, who is Vibhuti Garg. She's an energy economist. So she's going to tell us what the prospects are, especially, you know, we all keep seeing these headlines in the papers. We are all seeing these headlines in the papers that solar prices are falling to 2 rupees. Solar prices are going to fall more. So can solar actually work at these prices? Will the developers still be able to give it to make some money? Because if they cannot make any money, they're not going to put in money. And then, so an energy economist is somebody who can really start us off in this. And we are going to move to Vibhuti now. I'll just start the video for Vibhuti in a moment. Bob, will you start the video for Vibhuti Garg, please?
Hi, everyone.
Yeah.
Great. Thanks, Joydeep, and thanks, Apna, for the quick introduction about the state of affairs in Maharashtra in the renewable energy sector. The state really has huge renewable energy potential, as you pointed out. To promote, you know, deployment of more and more renewable energy, state Maharashtra Electricity Regulatory Commission has from time to time taken various initiatives and also has set up a huge renewable purchase obligation target. In 2015, it came out with the state renewable energy policy and further came out with solar irrigation pump schemes specifically for agricultural consumers in order to promote more and more deployment of solar in the agriculture sector, and also, you know, with the net metering scheme to promote solar rooftop, among many other. The state has approximately 5 gigawatt of installed wind capacity by now, and by 2022, you know, the state plans to extend it to 7,600 megawatt. It has already exploited around 75% of its wind capacity. So while there are some sites still available, but I think the state can increase its generation by refurbishing its old sites and, you know, deploying more recent technologies and increasing the heights that can probably add to more generation because as I said, you know, most of the sites have good sites have already been exploited in Maharashtra as far as the wind capacity is concerned. The private sector played a very major role and has invested around 12,000 odd crores in wind generation. And also, you know, this was led by government investor friendly policies. So that has been a huge positive. As far as solar is concerned, it has installed about 1.8 gigawatt, but there is huge potential, as Sapna was pointing out, with Maharashtra having 250 to 300 days of solar being available. So there is huge potential there, which needs to be exploited in the state. While good things have happened and Maharashtra is one of the leading states in India with, you know, a lot of renewable energy installed capacity, however, we have identified that there are some barriers in achieving the future targets which have been set up in the state. First and foremost, I think the state DISCOM struggles with expensive thermal PPAs. So this prevents the state to install more RE capacity as the DISCOM is liable to pay fixed charges for thermal assets, even if they don't procure power from such assets. And given the current situation with demand not picking up, this is adding to DISCOM woes. Secondly, the DISCOM has accumulated overdue payment of around 7,500 odd crores as of September 2020. This was around 12,000 crore just 2-3 months back. So, you know, with this scheme of 1.2 trillion liquidity infusion scheme, where PFC and REC are giving subsidized loans to these distribution companies, Maharashtra has received around 15,000 crores from the central government on this, and you know, which has is eased financial situation a little bit. But unless the underlying issues are addressed, this situation is likely to continue. So yeah, that becomes a big bottleneck for distribution companies on commercial as grounds, not kind of off taking a lot of renewable energy while there is scope for development there. Thirdly, I would say the state has levied now additional grid support charges for net metering rooftop solar system. This is done to compensate for under-recovery of its infrastructure costs because, rooftop solar reduces the utilization of the distribution network. This is required because, if distribution companies has undertaken expenditure and they need to recover it. But however, these kinds of policy uncertainty, really kind of impacts the decisions that were made. This kind of delays the whole progress that the state has made, because such policy uncertainty do have a negative impact on investors. Another thing would be the intrastate network availability. While we don't see any congestion in interstate transfer, and India has now synchronous grid, national grid, where capacity can be transferred at any corner of the country with synchronous grid. But we keep hearing from developers that there are times, there is congestion in the intrastate network capability. So there is a scope that, the network capability needs to be improved for more and more offtake of RE in the state. Finally, I would say, there is absence of analytical tools for proper forecasting and scheduling of this intermittent RE power. So this adds to, difficulties for DISCOM to absorb because there are no proper forecasting and scheduling tools that are available to them. While there has been some improvements made, but we are still not equipped with such tools, most of the DISCOMs, including Maharashtra. So few broad recommendations that the state can do to adopt more RE power. First, the state has a large consumer base, and Maharashtra being one of the big India's agrarian states, with agriculture occupying about 25% of total power consumption. And on the other hand, we have industries and commercial consumers who adds up to another 45% of total energy consumption in Maharashtra. So these are the two big sectors in Maharashtra, and there is both for agriculture as well as for commercial and industries, large scope for RE adoption. So this agricultural demand can be met through solar. So MSEDCL needs to harness, more and more solar, both at decentralized level and as well as at feeder level to provide, good quality daytime power supply to the farmers. This will in turn also help distribution companies to manage its peak energy demand as well as to reduce its T&D losses. So it's a win-win situation. So if the state has already announced schemes, as I was talking about, if it can accelerate that deployment of solar for farmers, it can really be a win-win situation for both the farmers as well as the distribution companies. Similarly, the state needs to, there has been a slowdown in, solar rooftop adoption in the state. So if state can come up with more policy conducive environment where more and more industries and commercial and consumers can, including residential as well, but there is a big scope for C&I consumers given that they have high tariffs, electricity tariffs. So for them, it is commercially more viable. And as I was saying that, 45% of the total electricity is consumed by such consumers. So there is a large scope there. And coming up with schemes like time of day pricing, which is already there, but kind of extending it so that, more and more consumers can benefit out of it. I think we we do see there's a large scope there. Thirdly, you know, by reducing reliance on power purchase from old inefficient plants. So if the state can optimize its power purchase by taking less power from these high cost plants, which not only adds to air pollution, but water pollution as well. So, you know, retiring these old thermal plants would increase demand from these low costly renewable energy. And lastly, as I said, you know, deployment of analytical tools would be crucial for state to take advantage of, you know, market developments and innovations such as real-time market. Now, given that, you know, we do have products on the power exchange, which are near to the time of delivery. So real-time market, as well as we have GTAM, the green term ahead market. So in order to take advantage of these kind of products, you need to deploy analytical tools and which can enable these distribution companies to supply, to sell its surplus power. Also for developers to, you know, sell their renewable energy on the power exchange as well. So these are some of the recommendations which if the state can adopt can help in better and penetration of renewable energy and more adoption by the state. Joydeep, I'll close my open remarks here. Happy to take questions.
Right. Okay, later. Yeah, thank you very much. Thanks a lot, Vibhuti. And I think at least I got a lot of story ideas. I'm sure everybody got it too. I can see from the question posed to you that they have understood what you're talking about. Now here is information for all of you who are participating. We shall share the recording of this so you can listen to what Vibhuti has said again. Not a problem at all. In case you have missed something in the hurry. So maybe you don't want to take notes now. Maybe it makes more sense for you to listen to what the speakers are saying because the recording will be available to you. Not a problem. But as I said, I can see story ideas coming. I can see the same story idea has occurred to at least one of my journalist colleagues because it's there in the Q&A for Vibhuti. She may want to answer it online by typing an answer, or she may want to answer it after all the panelists have spoken. That's up to her. The question basically is that the Uday scheme doesn't seem to be sustainable. So now in the long term, what does one do to keep these DISCOMs viable and going? Because without distribution companies, where's the electricity? Other story ideas are definitely there from what she said about round-the-clock auctions that have started now to take care of the fact that you get solar only certain hours of the day or wind only certain hours of the day. So round-the-clock auctions have started. Then she talked about GTAM, which is the green technology market, green energy market. So now one of the things that the government is trying is that, okay, if you can't get a purchasing agreement with your own state DISCOM, can you sell your energy that you are producing on the open market? So that's one possibility. And I think it's very important that she reiterated the importance of analytical tools. Because without that, neither the DISCOMs, nor the policymakers, nor us journalists can actually figure out to what extent renewable energy can work at what level. And the other thing that she pointed out, which again I think is a very important story idea, is the need and the importance of using solar in farming, especially decentralized solar in farming and in agriculture. That actually segues us wonderfully to our next panelist, Shantanu Dikshit from Prayas Energy Group in Pune. As I'm sure many of my colleagues know, Prayas has been doing excellent work on renewable energy. Based out of Pune, they have been doing a lot of work in Maharashtra. They, of course, work all over India. But since they're based out of Pune, they do a lot of work in Maharashtra. And Shantanu is going to tell us about it. And here is another bit of information for all my colleagues. In case you have any problem understanding any particular word or phrase that any panelist says that, and you want that translated into Marathi, please say so. Please say so in the Q&A box. We shall request those panelists. Shantanu knows Marathi very well. So, and you can ask your questions in Marathi as well. So please do not hesitate if you want anything to be translated into Marathi. Thank you. Shantanu, over to you.
Thank you, Jaideep. It's a pleasure to be here and share a few thoughts with journalist friends. Maybe many of you already know about Prayas, but Prayas is a policy research and advocacy group. We are based in Pune. We also do a lot of consumer advocacy, and a number of occasions we participate in various proceedings before MERC and to further consumer issues. So that's our very brief background. More details about our work can be found on our website, which is prayaspune.org. Now, in today's context, I want to highlight only a few points considering the time limitation. First point is Maharashtra has always been a very leader, so to say, when it comes to renewable energy and related issues. Way back in early 2000, Maharashtra was one of the earliest states we started with feed-in tariff. Now, what is feed-in tariff? Feed-in tariff is essentially the rate at which the distribution company will buy electricity from renewable energy generators. So this feed-in tariff gives a lot of confidence and security to renewable energy generators, you know, in terms of putting up new plants. And that's the result why Maharashtra has seen a large number of wind energy projects that came up in the decade of 2000. And this approach of having feed-in tariff was replicated in other states also, and that has significantly contributed to development of renewable energy. Similar such example, and which is sort of more recent example, is this solar feeder approach, where Maharashtra decided to solarize agriculture by deploying solar power plants at the substation on at the feeder level. You know, Maharashtra has these separate feeders which supply only to agricultural consumers. On those feeders, there are only agricultural pumps are connected. And these feeders are then connected to solar power, which is deployed at the substation level. Now, the beauty of this approach is here the solar power is generated at about 3 rupees per unit, whereas the overall cost of power purchase is more than 4.5 rupees per unit. So straight away, you are able to reduce your cost of power procurement, and thereby you are able to reduce the cost of supply to agriculture. So your burden of cross subsidy or subsidy that government has to give goes down very significantly. Secondly, along with this, you are also able to provide good quality daytime power to farmers, you know, which is a big advantage or big requirement of farmers, that they do want to get power during daytime and avoid going to farms during night time. So this was the scheme that started in Maharashtra. About 3000 megawatt of solar power deployment is planned using this kind of solar feeder approach for solarization of agriculture. And there is a good response for this scheme from farmers. So this is one probably the story idea that journalist friends can pick up in terms of trying to see what is farmers' response and how farmers are responding to this scheme. Now, because this is a win-win-win situation for farmers, they get good quality daytime supply. For distribution company, they are not required to buy high cost power. And in terms of renewable energy, because it allows use of daytime generation, you know, which is typically because of solar, to be used in agriculture. So this demand and supply matching also becomes quite easy. So in that sense, this is the win-win-win situation for all stakeholders. And that's why it has been picked up at the central government level also. Under the Kusum program of Government of India, there is a very significant component which is dedicated to this kind of feeder-based solarization of agriculture. Now, based on this, many other states such as Haryana, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh have also decided to undertake a very similar program. So this really demonstrates that Maharashtra's innovative approaches, Maharashtra's willingness to have new models or new policy measures have yielded significant benefit, not just for the state, but has become some kind of a model that is replicated in multiple states. So these are a couple of examples about how Maharashtra is in a way leading state when it comes to renewable energy. Another recent example is Maharashtra Regulatory Commission came out with this net metering regulations recently last year. And these regulations also provide a lot of clarity to renewable energy developers, consumers in terms of what to expect when it comes to installing solar rooftop. It gives a lot of policy certainty because these regulations say that till the time we reach about 2000 megawatt of renewable energy based on rooftop or net metering approach, there will not be any grid support charges. Similarly, it also gives clarity that all behind meter systems, how they will be treated. So because of this net metering regulations, for next 3 to 4 years, there is very good clarity for consumers as well as developers in terms of what to expect when it comes to policy regulatory measures or support for rooftop sector. I am sure that these measures or this policy regulatory approach will also be sort of adopted or copied in many other states, because this is another way of giving significant regulatory clarity. So with this, let me come to where we are in terms of renewable energy and where we need to go, or what are what the future lies in terms of renewable energy in the state. If we see in the last about a decade or so, our installed capacity has grown by about from literally sort of very insignificant renewable energy to current installed capacity of about 10 gigawatt. So there has been a very significant increase in renewable energy capacity installations in the state. When it comes to actual generation, currently about 10% of our total generation or total demand is being met by renewable energy. When I'm saying renewable energy, it's largely wind and solar, and to a certain extent, cogeneration, biomass based generation, and micro hydro or mini hydro generation projects. But essentially, going forward, a large increase is going to come from wind and solar projects, because that's where a significant scale can be achieved. Now, in the last decade, what we have observed is the cost of generation from renewable energy has reduced quite significantly. In early or say mid 2000, it was about 11 to 12 rupees per unit. And today the cost of generation from solar project is definitely below 3. And if we one go by very recent and very aggressive bidding that we observed in some of the national level programs, it has gone to about 2 rupees per unit. So even if we consider that the solar generation would be available at about 2.5 rupees per unit, it is significantly lower than the cost of new coal-based projects. New coal-based projects are unlikely to come at less than 4 rupees per unit tariff. So it just makes economic sense to have more and more renewable energy to meet our growing energy demand. But I will come to the issue of how do we meet demand during night time when there is no solar generation, or demand during seasons when there is no wind generation. So I will come to that issue in a minute. But just to complete this story, that because renewable energy is today one of the cheapest source of meeting our energy demand, here again, Maharashtra Regulatory Commission has set a very path-breaking regulation in terms of renewable portfolio obligation. As per these regulations, all distribution companies are required to procure at least a minimum percentage of their energy through renewable sources. And what Maharashtra Regulatory Commission has specified is by year 2025, all these distribution companies must procure at least 25% of their energy through renewable energy. So just to give a context, today we are at procuring about 10% of our requirement through renewable energy, but in the next 5 years, we need to scale it up to about 25% of renewable energy procurement out of total demand. And what it essentially means is all our incremental demand, whatever we are going to demand in next, whatever is going to be increase in our energy demand in next 5 years, 100% of that demand will be essentially met through increase in renewable energy generation. So which is a very fundamental transition or change that we are going to observe in coming 5 years. And mind you, because the cost of renewable energy is quite reasonable or cheaper than coal-based generation, you know, it's not going to add any financial burden on consumers. In fact, as I will share in the next few minutes, it's going to be cheaper for consumers to actually go for more and more renewable energy. So here again, Maharashtra is setting a very path-breaking and ambitious target for adoption of renewable energy. Now, here again, in order to address this issue of, you know, how do we meet demand? Because solar generates only during daytime, whereas our demand may be during nighttime also. There are two primary measures that could be adopted. One is the kind of solar feeder approach that I mentioned. Now, what happens because of this solar feeder approach is you are actually able to shift all your agricultural pumping demand to daytime when solar is available and solar plants are generating at its maximum. So because of this approach, you are able to add more and more renewable energy into the grid without creating imbalance in terms of demand and supply. Now, secondly, in the last year, we did a very detailed exercise in terms of what will be demand in 2030, which is sort of 10 years from now. In every 15 minutes of year 2030, what will be the demand and how we can meet that demand using various generation technologies, whether it is hydro, whether it is wind, solar, using our existing coal or buying electricity through exchanges and power markets. And importantly, also considering large scale grid batteries. You know, there is significant progress has been made in terms of lithium ion batteries or many other battery technologies are coming up at a very rapid pace. Their cost is decreasing very significantly. You know, as we have seen significant cost reduction in wind and solar generation cost, a similar reduction is expected in grid scale battery storage. So if you integrate all these technology options along with their likely costs in 2030, then this very advanced detailed modeling that we carried out, you know, which is based on, which is technically called as production cost simulation, which gives you what would be demand every 15 minutes of the day and how that demand could be met in most cost optimal manner without compromising in terms of reliability, without increasing shortages. So the results of that modeling exercise are also very striking. What we observed that we can very comfortably target about 50% of our energy demand to be met through wind and solar resources. So currently we are at 10% in 2020. MERC has stipulated a target of 25% RPO by 2025. And by 2030, in cost economical manner, we can actually target 50% of our demand being met through renewable energy. And this will come at a cost which will be about 5 to 6% lower than a business as usual scenario, which is continuing with existing kind of supply mix. So adding significant amount of renewable energy is not going to compromise in terms of the reliability of the grid, is not going to increase shortages. We will be able to meet our demand in a most cost optimal manner, actually at a less cost than business as usual scenario. Now, what are implications of this scenario? You know, one is today we are talking about 10,000 megawatt of renewable energy capacity in the state. Now that needs to really increase by about 5 times. So in the next 10 years, we need to install our additional 40,000 megawatt capacity. So by 2030, we need to have about 50,000 megawatts of wind and solar capacity put together to actually achieve this target of 50% and actually reducing our cost of supply. This would entail also deploying about 5 gigawatt or 5,000 megawatts of battery systems. you know, today there are no large scale, grid scale battery systems that we are deploying in the state. But we need to urgently start that process and start procurement on pilot basis so that we can, you know, in the subsequent 5 to 7 years, we can really ramp up this battery deployment, which will help us address the seasonal variation as well as daily variation in our generation sources because of wind and solar. And that will ensure that we have reliable electricity supply without increasing the cost of supply in any manner. So that becomes the second requirement. And this would entail an investment of about 1.5 lakh crore in the next decade. So it's a huge opportunity to have significant investment in the state without increasing burden on either state government or on consumers in any manner. Because this investment will largely come from private sector in the form of power purchase agreements, and consumers of electricity will actually repay this investment in the form of annual tariff or the power purchase procurement cost. So without stretching state finances, without burdening consumers, we can actually have a very significant increase in renewable energy in the states. And that's where the Maharashtra is well poised to achieve those targets or to move towards that kind of scale. And I hope Maharashtra will again prove its leadership and innovation and in terms of policy and regulatory measures and to actually achieve these targets. So I will stop here, and in the chat box I will share two links from our website. One is about the solar feeder program that I mentioned. You know, it's a just a 3-minute audio visual it's a video that everybody can watch and just get a good sense of what that scheme is. And another one is the webinar that we had held on this power sector modeling exercise we did, which really demonstrated how we can meet 50% of our demand through renewable sources without compromising on our reliability as well as without increasing cost. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Shantanu. You know, for every participant, a piece of information: that background photo you see behind me is of a solar feeder in Maharashtra. That's a photo of a solar feeder for irrigation in Maharashtra. I think this was extremely useful, and there are lots of story ideas that I got which can definitely be done by journalists based in Marathwada, in Vidarbha, in coastal Maharashtra. There are many story ideas that we got. There are also, I can see that people are following this carefully because there are questions there for Shantanu in the Q&A. Again, Shantanu, it's up to you after you have shared these links, whether you want to answer these questions online in the Q&A box or take them, discuss them after all the panelists have spoken. That's up to you. There is an important question there about farmers using solar irrigation indiscriminately and therefore thereby taking up too much groundwater. It's a question that we definitely need to discuss. And these are story ideas. Right. Let's move on. Let's move on to Ulka. Ulka Kelkar is the climate change head of World Resources Institute India, and that is somebody who has been working on this in this field for quite some time now and has a lot of insights for us which will give us story ideas. Ulka, over to you.
Thank you very much, Joydeep, and you can hear me, I hope, clearly.
Yes, can you see
my screen?
Yes, we can see your screen.
Yes. So, well, so many experts among the participants that I'm very hesitant to speak. Many of the journalists who are in the participants, I follow them on Twitter. I read their stories. So what I thought I could do was complement the two other panelists and give a slightly more global picture, a slightly more national picture, go a little behind the numbers, and also present some examples of the human stories that lie behind the policies and data that we've been discussing. So let me start with that. And as Joydeep said before, I'll try to say a few words in Marathi. Please feel free to ask questions or stop at any point to ask me for any clarification. So why are we talking about renewable energy or clean energy? We're talking about it because, because if the world needs to stay within a safe global warming of 1.5 degrees Celsius by the end of this century, then greenhouse gas emissions globally have to be what are called net zero by the middle of the century. So right now, the current situation is that the world is emitting 5,000 crore ton carbon dioxide. Ani tyacha ardha vhayla lagel 10 varshat. In 10 years, we need to cut global emissions by half. Ani jar safe global warming havi asli, tar 30 varshat he carbon emissions almost shunya vhayla lagtil. Now, we don't say shunya, we don't say zero, we say net zero. Now, what does that mean? By that, we mean that emissions will never become completely zero, completely gone, based on our conventional mitigation techniques, je technologies amchyakade ahe. Pan net zero vayla lagel by 2050. So what we need to do is take away some of that carbon through planting trees or through even other kinds of more advanced technologies. So that's why we use the word net zero. And in this net zero pathway, almost 80% of electricity has to come from renewable sources. If we don't do that, then this net zero pathway and safe climate change is going to be just wishful thinking. It will not be a reality. So let's look at a lot of recent announcements have been coming in the last 2 months. And in fact, even more so will come in the next month or two. China, Japan, Korea, ya sagranni announce kele ki ami net zero honar aho 2060 varshi kiwa 2050 varshi. Je navin US president aale Joe Biden, he fought on what is said to be the most ambitious climate campaign in US election history, and he has promised that the US will reach net zero emissions no later than 2050 and that he'll rejoin the Paris Agreement. UK has just this week, as part of their budget, made a lot of new announcements. For example, they've said no new petrol and diesel cars will be sold from 2030. And there are more announcements also for energy. But leave alone countries, even companies like Infosys, Reliance, Unilever, many of these companies operating in India have made net zero pledges. Some of them are very ambitious. Some of them have said that even our past emissions, we will completely cancel out through advanced technologies or through buying offsets from planting trees. So there's a lot of news that is almost coming out every day for those who follow this field. Joydeep, just let me know if there's any relevant question because I'm not monitoring the chat box.
Yeah, not a problem. Yeah,
go ahead. Okay. If there is one that requires an immediate response. Yeah.
Correct, yeah, thanks. The other big thing that is happening is, of course, corona. And because of the economic contraction that is happening, like the UK economy has just announced that they are expected to contract by 11% this year, and they'll return to pre-pandemic levels only at the end of 2022. So a lot of countries all around the world are announcing stimulus packages. And Energy Policy Tracker is one of the organizations that tracks how much of this stimulus money is going to fossil fuel sectors and how much of it is going to clean sectors. Like, for example, if you're bailing out an airline and the aviation industry, are you making it conditional on some kind of energy efficiency improvements or some other kinds of measures by which they will reduce their greenhouse gas emissions? Or are you just giving it free to them? So, one of the numbers that we can see is that for every $3 that is going towards fossil energy, $2 is for clean energy. And someone had asked in the chat box, what about nuclear energy? Nuclear energy is considered in other. It is not neither fossil nor is it really renewable energy or clean energy. But the interesting thing is that for India's commitment, our commitment is that we will have 40% of energy from electricity from non-fossil fuel sources. So we are keeping with us the option of using nuclear, of using large hydro, in addition to the kinds of solar, wind, small hydro that we've been talking about in this presentation. So let's go a little bit behind the numbers for India. And this is a model that WRI India has helped to develop. And you can see at the bottom of the screen the web link for that. And there's also a small 10-minute video. Ek 10 minutes a video je tumhi bagu shakta. Yacha sagra explain kelela hai ki how, if you look at the existing scenarios, the existing policies, je kai Bharat Sarkarache schemes ahe, there's a sagra tya trajectory was ya pathway was jar ami challo, the what will be the growth in the economy which will lead to a growth in demand for electricity. So, you know, just as Vibhuti pointed out in her presentation, it is the residential and commercial sectors which are already paying more for electricity, which are actually where the great demand for electricity is coming from. Buildings is blue, industry is the gray. And these are also basically our cities that are being built and our infrastructure that is being built. This is the source of our GDP growth and our jobs. So although there is a lot of scope for energy efficiency in materials, both in big companies and in small MSMEs, there's a lot of scope for rooftop solar, but we do need supportive policies. As Vibhuti said, you know, if the policies are changing or there's confusion or there's lack of awareness, then this potential will not be met. Another reason why rooftop solar becomes more important is Rishika was there in the participant list. She has been writing a lot about how land in India is scarce, it is ecologically rich, and it supports livelihoods of farmers, pastoralists. You know, if you go only for utility scale, large scale solar parks and do not give equal emphasis to rooftop solar, there will be some inadvertent consequences which we need to avoid. If you look at where the electricity is coming from, just as Shantanu said, you know, if we look at even current policies, yellow is solar, light blue is wind, you know, most and dark blue is hydro. So by 2050 going forward, more than half of our electricity, this is for India, will come from renewable energy sources. But the gray is coal. And if we don't have policies to reduce the, you know, the coal power plants, to retire some of the inefficient power plants early, we will be stuck with plants that don't pay for themselves, that become inefficient economically, don't make business sense. And also our greenhouse gas emissions will continue to rise even if we have so much of renewable energy in our mix. One last slide from the same model, which is that, you know, sometimes the stories lie slightly hidden. So when we talk about energy, we've talked about agriculture, we've talked about power sector, but if you look at transport, transport also uses energy. And if you see where the major source of emissions is coming from and the growing source, it is coming from freight trucks, the black one. At the time of independence, India used to transport most of its goods and services by the railways. But now, because of a number of reasons, we are transporting them more and more by trucks that run on diesel. So this is where there is scope for the modal shift back towards railways, for electrification of these trucks, and for more fuel efficiency standards, even for the fossil fuel running trucks. So let me just stop with a few very brief glimpses into some human examples, and the presentation will be shared and the links show you the whole story. Some of these have been carried by Nidhi Jamwal on the Gaon Connection website as well. So our work with hospitals in Jharkhand has shown that, you know, small rural hospitals for whom it is important to have uninterrupted power supply to run ventilators, for example, during this COVID pandemic, they are not able to get uninterrupted power supply and they have to spend 3 to 4 lakhs a month on diesel. So there are examples now of hospitals which have installed solar power and have run ventilators during the pandemic. But the cost of something like 50 lakhs is very prohibitive for these small hospitals. So there is a need for new business models. Corporate social responsibility can step into support. But also, just like we have EMIs, easy monthly installments for our phones or Netflix subscriptions or for buying anything, similarly, you could have pay-as-you-go business models for renewable energy as well. In Assam, solar panels, solar powered boat clinics have been used for remote islands in the river, which otherwise don't have electricity connections. In Rajasthan, in the Thar Desert, where actually the villages are electrified, but they're single phase connections. And in order to run bore wells to get access to any water, you need the three phase connection. People over here use diesel run bore wells. But there is a recent example of solar powered bore wells, which have been used to create these above ground or ground level reservoirs, because of which women are able to collect water for their daily use, and livestock also can be fed. The most important story that is emerging now, that a lot of you are already writing about, is this issue of, you know, as this renewable energy transition happens, as we switch from coal towards cleaner forms, what will be the jobs impact, the livelihood impact? And the expression that is being used is, will it be a just transition, a fair transition? A pramanik aheka. If you look at the kinds of new jobs that clean energy might bring, the construction jobs might be fulfilled by migrant laborers from other places. And meanwhile, the locals might not get access either to the electricity or to the land or to the jobs. So some countries like Spain have created funds called Just Transition Funds to support the people whose jobs are affected by shutting down coal power plants. But in India, we may need a much deeper approach. We may need safety nets, social dialogue, access to finance, and reskilling. So let me just stop there. And thank you very much for this opportunity.
Well, thanks a lot, Ulka. Again, lots of story ideas. And interestingly, again, good examples of stories that have already been done and are already published. And that, to my mind, is important, because I know what all of you journalists will face when you take these story ideas to your editors. Your editor is going to turn around and say, so what's new? So now, our own colleague, another journalist who works in this particular area, is going to tell us what's new. What are the new story ideas? Vandana Gombar, for those of you, most of you know her, I'm just reminding you, she's editor of Global Policy at Bloomberg New Energy Finance. So these are stories she does every day. That's what she does for a living. So what are the new stories? What are the new story ideas that you can come up with? Over to you, Vandana.
Thank you very much, Joydeep. Am I audible and clear?
Yes, totally. Oh,
wonderful, wonderful. So I'm going to take off from where Joydeep started. What's new is a question we tackle every day. I work with Bloomberg NEF. It used to be New Energy Finance, but we just refer to ourselves as Bloomberg NEF now. And our whole living is based on tracking the energy transition, which also includes transition in the mobility sector, the move towards EVs, a lot of things. So I just want to make 5-6 key points for those of you who are writing and active in this sector. And they are not specific to Maharashtra, because I think the speakers before me have covered that really well. And also, I'm not so familiar with Maharashtra, except for a couple of models that passed my desk, and I shall talk about that. So the first thing that I wanted to say was that writing about energy, climate, and sustainability, all of it is new. The knowledge is still evolving. The definitions are still evolving. Ulka spoke about net zero. So we're talking about net zero emissions. What does that actually mean? Did you know that carbon neutral is different from climate neutral? Even people who are like very well vested in this sector are struggling to understand the nuances and the differences. So everything that we are writing here is kind of new and well has the potential to create an aha moment for the user. So for the reader, I'm sorry, not the user. So I just think that it's an exciting field to be in, to write about, to be part of. Telling the story of even finalizing definitions of companies that are green, of you will hear the term greenwashing, companies announcing policies that are kind of trying to show that they're green, but they're not actually green because definitions are not finalized. So it's an interesting place to be in, and there are very interesting stories to write. The second point I wanted to make is that it's interesting to relate what you're writing to your readers. So I guess if I am, if you're writing about, let's say, global warming and sea level rise, how does it impact the wide variety of readers? Do they care? They will care if it impacts the price of their beach house, if it impacts the price of the fish, if it impacts health, if it impacts, you know, all those related things. So I think it's part of the storyteller's job to educate and also inform the reader. So one way of doing that is to look for these linkages, and that makes it come alive. You know, if India chooses to go for a net zero target, hypothetically speaking, there is a lot of speculation that we might, because as Ulka said, there's been this host of announcements and quite a few from Asia. So we had China and Korea and Japan just doing it in the last few weeks. And so suppose India does go for net zero emissions, for instance, what does that mean for, let's say, my power bill again, my health? I think those linkages are, there's a scope for drawing out more of those linkages. The third point I want to make, and which again has been already mentioned by my previous speakers, many stories are local, and I think, you know, so I've been speaking to Energy Efficiency Services Limited, and they are the ones I think who are piloting a model of doing a lot more agriculture, solarizing of agriculture in Maharashtra. And some data which came from the PFC utilities report was talking about how it takes over 7 rupees to supply power to agriculture consumer in Maharashtra, and the revenue is 1 rupee. So here is EESL going to Maharashtra and saying, I'm going to provide you a package which will have solar power, which will probably have some street lighting, which will have a battery. And the whole package is available for a cost of 4 rupees per unit. It still doesn't cover, it's higher than the revenue that is generated from the agriculture consumer, but the gap between 1 and 4 is certainly lower than the gap between 1 and 7. And that's a straight saving of a few thousand crore rupees. So there are some very interesting stories that can be very local. I did not know that Maharashtra has this amazing irrigation, irrigation ponds is what I was told. It's one of the states which has done a lot of work on irrigation, and there are a lot of these irrigation ponds that are available to host floating solar. So there are some pilots that are in the works. They're thinking about scaling it up. Solar, as you know, as we mentioned, the latest bid for solar is it's utility scale solar with a lot of incentives, but the last bid that came in earlier this week was 2 rupees per unit. And given the amount of sunlight that we have in this country, and as Sapna mentioned at the beginning, that Maharashtra is one of the states which is well suited to solar power, then you just need to see what strands need to come together to make sure that you're using the cheapest power, and that means that everyone's power bills are going down, because that 7 rupees cost of supply to the agricultural consumer who's only paying 1 rupee is reflected in your power bill. It's reflected in what you are paying, what the industry is paying, what the commercial entities are paying. And it's all linked to what path the country follows. Let's say we're talking about we're talking about Atmanirbhar Bharat now, and we're talking about local manufacturing. Can you really do local manufacturing if your industrial consumers are subsidizing power that is used by agriculture and by households? So, in an indirect way, if you stretch that linkage a little, it's also linked to the jobs that would possibly come if you had cheap power and you had more industry and it was cheaper to manufacture in the country. So I just wanted to, on this point, just essentially say there are some stories which are very local, and a person who's based in Maharashtra can tell them better than anyone else and essentially provide a window into what's happening in Maharashtra for a global audience. And I think that would be an amazing value add, because for any of us who are not in Maharashtra, we cannot really have the intelligence that you do. I also think that this might be a bit controversial, but I also think that maybe writers have a role to play in informing and educating the audience about the energy choices that each country is making. I don't think that someone sitting somewhere in a closed room should be deciding what is the best source of energy for India. I would be interested in making sure that the energy I'm getting is not making poison air for someone. It's not polluting. It's not harming life. So if you have the, you know, Maharashtra, as we again saw from the slides, there is a lot of wind, there is a lot of solar, and the coal share is also there. But essentially, I mean, you know, this whole conversation of like, do you want a nuclear plant in your backyard? Not in my backyard. The whole NIMBY movement. Do you want a coal power plant in your backyard? No, you don't. But why should somebody else have it in their backyard? So I just think that there need to be some conversation that we need to have about the choices we are making as a country. In the rest of the world, in many parts of the world, you can choose the source of power you want to consume. So I was based in UK for a bit. I can get my power from a company which is telling me that you will get it, it's 100% green power. So our minister, recent interview, he said, we will give you that option. Ultimately, you will have the choice of who your power supplier is going to be. So initially there were these voluntary consumers and companies who said, I want to be 100% powered by green, and I am willing to pay a premium for it. And then solar and wind became so cheap that if you're 100% powered by renewables, your bill is actually lower than it would be otherwise. And there are lots of business models evolving, and I'm sure they will evolve in India too. But I just think that we don't have enough of a conversation about it. We don't have enough of a conversation about how we're going to power India for the next 2 decades or 3 decades. We have a conversation between the experts, but I mean, like in the general mainstream media. Second last point was keep an eye on technology, what is evolving. So are there new kinds of panels? There was a time that we were talking about building integrated PV, so you could just have a film on your window and essentially sunlight falling on it is transformed to energy. Or is there you know, power from waves, power from tides, lots of things which are not yet commercial, but there are lots of interesting projects. I would say pre-pilot projects that are being worked on. And if I'm a writer in this sector, then it's a good idea to keep an eye on those and see what is possible in your state. I just read about a community solar project for irrigation in Chhattisgarh, supported by the Chhattisgarh Renewable Energy Agency. So there's a lot of work on solar and agriculture and just kind of bringing the two together. And in terms of, so there are two ways solarization of agriculture can happen. One is by just making sure that the power that's going in there is coming from solar power plants. And the second thing is actually integrating solar and agriculture. So you have solar panels on top and crops growing underneath. And in terms of what can happen there, I think India, with its scale of agriculture and with its solar resource potential, I mean, it could be, I think it is possible that it may well emerge a world leader in solar agriculture. My last point was on drawing interesting linkages. We have a lot of countries that have announced that they're going to be 100% moving to electric vehicles. So yes, India also announced it. We wanted to do that by 2030. We kind of retracted that. We are going slowly towards electric vehicles. So what does that really mean? So there are stories that are linked to, the models of vehicles that are likely to be launched, the charging infrastructure that's being put up, the policies that support it, the financial incentives that are available. But there is another side of it. So what is a government's or a state government's key source of revenue? One of it is fuel sales. So if you have a lot of EVs, does that impact the revenue of the state government? It does. So how is it going to finance itself? So there are these interesting linkages which are like going a step beyond and just looking at policy and seeing where all it will impact. Ulka just talked about essentially reskilling people. So if you're going to not set up a certain kind of power plants and you don't need that skill, then what does it mean for employment? What does it mean for reskilling? What does it mean for different businesses? So I just think that we as writers should also be thinking about those linkages which haven't yet been thought about. So when you put all this together and you are asked what's new, well, everything is new. And that's what's exciting about writing in this space of energy and climate and sustainability. And that's why I remain excited about it. If you want to get some interesting primary data on what's being written, on revenues that are impacted because of the changes that are happening, I would obviously recommend my some of the things that are put outside the paywall on bnef.com. So there is a blog on bnef.com, which you will find some very useful write-ups. Whether it's like the next generation carbon abatement technologies, whether you're looking at hydrogen, whether you're looking at net zero, or some just essentially what the whatever is the theme of the week, the moment. So would recommend that. And of course, there are other sites that you'd all be aware of, data from World Resources Institute or IFA or IEA. That's it from my end. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Thank you, Vandana. Okay, people, lots of story ideas, lots of questions I can see. I'm very glad that you are so engaged. Vandana, there are questions for you also. So do take a look at the Q&A box. And yes, as we had agreed, we had said that we would, we'll all have an open discussion on story ideas. Just a moment before that, I'm just going to share with you everybody that there is a story grant proposal call out right now. So I just want to share that with all of you people so that you have a chance, okay, to apply for this. Can all of you see my screen?
Yes, it's visible.
Okay, thank you very much. So there is a story grant call out right now from the Earth Journalism Network on renewable energy in Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu. Please know that this call is the last date for putting in your applications is the 15th of December. So please do so. As with all our calls, make your own budget. But keep it around 90,000 for a story. Okay. Keep it around 90,000 per story, but make your own budget with its own justification for your expenses, your fees, everything. Importantly, I know that there are, and I'm very glad that apart from reporters in the print and the web media, there are photographers in the room today. So yes, photo features are most welcome. Come up with ideas on photo features that you can do. What Vandana just talked about, farm ponds, immediately brings an excellent photo feature to my mind, because these farm ponds, as I'm sure those of you who are from Marathwada especially know this, that in that entire Nashik Aurangabad area, much of the vineyards, most of the vineyards depend on these farm ponds. And the irrigation of the grapes is largely through these farm ponds. And what they're using right now to get that water from that pond to the vines in the vineyards is diesel. So if they can move that to solar, it makes an enormous amount of sense for them, for the farmers, and it does make an excellent photo feature to my mind. So just some story ideas. There are more details here. And the application process is given out here. And the deadline, as I said, is December 15, midnight. So please hurry up if you're interested in these story grants and apply. Good. I'm going to stop screen share. And look, what I am going to do is to see, okay, now how many questions and answers are still open? Because I can see that many of them have been answered. Are any of them still open? By the way, everybody, my colleague from IT, Tob, has shared the link in the chat box so that you can all click on that and go to that page, which gives you the link for the story grant proposal. All right. Now, there's a couple of questions that are still... Okay, I can see one question from Meena, which I think Shantanu is probably best placed to answer. Any ground level studies on how solar is working for farmers and in which parts of the state is it working well for irrigation pump sets? Shantanu, would you like to take that? Shantanu has lost the line. Okay. All right. Meena, would any other panelists like to take that question? Otherwise, we'll ask Shantanu over mail to take this. Okay, all right. I don't see anybody's hand going up. So that's fine. Meena, I'm going to send this question to Shantanu over mail. Hopefully that will work. Yeah, he's having an internet issue. I can see that. That's fine. If he joins, we can ask him that question. Let's see what other open questions are here open. Okay, all right, Meena. So this will be answered. Others have been answered. I can see. Now tell me, all of you. You can see that your questions have been answered by the panelists through the Q&A box. Are there any follow-up questions from any of you? Any follow-up questions, anybody? Tob, can we... I'm first going to make a request to everybody that please keep yourself muted except when you want to talk. So given that, Tob, can we unmute everybody? Is that possible? Does the software allow that? Yeah, okay. So all of you, please keep yourselves muted except when you want to talk. We are from our end, we are unmuting everybody. Okay. So any follow-up questions? Yeah. I can see a question from Shai, which is again for Shantanu. Has Shantanu managed to get back? No, not yet. because this is the
I'm back. Okay, very sorry back. About you're... the internet
no you, yeah. you lost no, your line internet Shantanu, there, yeah Shantanu, there are two questions which we think you're probably best placed to answer. One is there any study on how well the farm solar for irrigation is working in Maharashtra and connected
I can't
to that...
hear you properly Jaydeep.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Little
can you
better.
Hear me now?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. So the question is from Meena Menon is that how any is there any study on how well solar based irrigation is working in Maharashtra and which parts of Maharashtra are best suited for solar based irrigation? That's the question from Meena. Did you hear that? I think Shantanu is having trouble with his line again. Yeah, that's a possibility.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah, now we can hear you. So did you hear the question?
Yes, I heard the question. Yeah. So quick answers to both questions. First is, Maharashtra started deploying these feeder-based solar plants about 1.5 years ago, you know, after completing the initial policy, regulatory and procurement process, bidding process, etc. So the initial feedback from farmers is very positive about daytime supply, good quality of voltage, etc. But beyond that, a formal study per se or a documented study is yet to be done. And the reason for that has been, you know, since last 8 months, there was no possibility of doing any field-based exercise. But whatever is the anecdotal feedback from farmers, it's a very positive feedback from farmers. They are actually going ahead and demanding very actively that these kind of schemes be expanded rapidly. So that is one short answer. Second is these projects are being planned in the entire state, whether it is Maharashtra, Vidarbha, Western Maharashtra, Khandesh. Essentially, these projects become very attractive and viable in places where there is a significant agricultural load, and because of which feeders are already separated into what is called as Gautan feeders, which supply exclusively to rural, residential and industrial load and to agricultural feeders. So wherever this feeder separation has happened, those are good sites for deploying this kind of projects. And there are these projects currently operational in all parts of Maharashtra.
Right. There's another question for you, Shantanu, from Shailendra Yashwant about, we all understand it's very critical. Battery development is very critical. What is the current state of battery development in India, in Maharashtra? Development, manufacturing, availability. What is the current state of the battery situation?
Yeah. Currently, as I have replied in my written answer, there is very limited battery deployment in India, let alone in Maharashtra. There are a handful of projects like Tata Power in Delhi who have deployed battery on experimental scale on pilot basis. So essentially, in terms of battery deployment, we are at a stage where we were in terms of solar deployment, let's say in early 2000. So these are experimental projects, pilot projects being undertaken. But globally, if we see, there is very significant scale at which batteries are being manufactured and deployed, whether it is Tesla or many other companies are deploying grid scale battery systems. And I'm not just talking about lithium ion, but many other battery types and battery chemistries will come up going forward. Recently, under production link incentive schemes, Government of India has also included advanced chemistry batteries sector as part of that PLI scheme. So there is significant work happening, but in terms of policy regulatory process, definitely there is a need to have a more supportive policy framework, regulatory framework to allow early deployment on experimental or pilot basis. Because if we deploy batteries right, in the immediate future, then that will give us the valuable operational commercial experience in terms of deploying batteries. And then in the next 4 to 5 years, when battery costs are expected to reduce significantly, we'll be able to really scale up deployment to the extent that is required, from a decadal perspective.
Joydeep, could I just add a couple of points
Please do.
One is that, you know, some of the new chemistries that Shantanu spoke about, I think there is a mission, DST is sort of doing some research on how to make sure that these are safe in India's climatic conditions, because, you know, the heat and then the road safety. Second is, if you remember the graph that I showed, which showed the huge share of freight trucks. Now, trucks are something which don't lend themselves well to battery charging. You know, even if you put EV charging stations along highways, it takes several hours to charge the truck. So there are limitations in terms of which types of applications, you know, can be pushed in the Indian context. Third, I think there's a lot of scope for people to write about issues around battery recycling. There are some startups which are trying to actually, you know, thinking of a self-sufficient economy in minerals, in these, you know, specific minerals, but I think there's a lot of scope there. And finally, the new emerging story is that around hydrogen, because a lot of industrial applications, but again, the catch there is, can the hydrogen be produced using renewable electricity? So can you have green hydrogen rather than using conventional electricity? And then where will that renewable energy come from? Is there enough land for it? But there is a lot of excitement around hydrogen, because instead of exporting coal, India could export hydrogen to other countries eventually. So a lot of possible stories to go into there. Thanks.
Thanks, Ulka. Right. Okay, I can see that Urvashi Sarkar wants to have a follow-up question. Yeah, please unmute yourself and go ahead. Urvashi? Hello? You are not audible, sorry. Okay, since we can't hear you, yeah, just type your question. Fine. Okay, I can see another question from Gautam Agarwal. Now, I don't know which panelist. Hello. Yeah, okay, Urvashi, now we can hear you. Go ahead.
Yeah, so I'm a freelance journalist based in Bombay. My question was, again, with regard to nuclear and, you know, the proposed, the grants that we can propose. For this and the story ideas. So in order to apply for the EGN grant, if I propose a story idea related to the use of nuclear energy in Maharashtra, would it be eligible, or are you not considering nuclear energy?
For this grant, we are considering only solar, wind, and possibly biomass.
I see. Nuclear is not eligible.
And not for this grant.
Okay, all right, thank you.
So there's a question from Gautam Agarwal on, is there a product stewardship program in place for the management of solar panels at the end of life? Which panelist would like to take this? What happens to solar panels at the end of their useful lives? Ulka?
No, I'm not aware.
Vibhuti?
Yeah.
Do you know this?
No, not really. But there are issues.
In which case, it's a good story idea.
Absolutely. I think there are technological solutions that people have been working on. But unfortunately, I am not aware whether any Indian sort of agency is actually doing a program on that. But it's definitely important area that one needs to look at, but there is technical research that has happened around this issue, and there are certain technical solutions that people are proposing, working on it.
I can add something there. Actually, my colleagues did some research on end-of-life solar panels. I don't have the data exactly in front of me, but the volumes are not so great now. So this is a challenge which will come a few years down the line. And I think they try to compare the waste that will come from solar panels versus from some other sectors, and even when it does come a few years down the line, it's a small proportion. And I think the main point there was that there's a lot of concern about some chemicals there, which might, if these panels go to the landfill, and by weight, those chemicals are like, it's in grams versus tons is what I recall of it. But I'll try to fish it out and share something on email if I can.
Right. There is actually an answer given in the Q&A box by Himanshu Mishra. Thank you, Himanshu. I think our colleagues can chase that. Go Google SunSource and chase that up. I also see a hand raised by Nivedita. Nivedita, go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. My question is very simple. What really ails the rooftop solar field? I mean, you know, there have been always a top-down approach. Is there any study at municipality level which says this is the problem? Why is it not very popular?
Maybe Shantanu, would you like to take that?
Yeah. Okay, it was for Shantanu.
Okay, Shantanu, would you like to take that question?
Can you repeat the question, please? There was some internet issue.
What really ails the rooftop solar propagation as much as it should have been?
No, as I mentioned, few months ago, there was significant regulatory uncertainty because MSEDCL had proposed certain additional charges, etc. So during that,
I suspect Shantanu is losing his internet connection repeatedly.
I could try to answer some of it while he gets back.
Please, until
he gets back. No, I think there are two or three types of issues. One is there is lack of information. Also, I think Shantanu is back. Do you want to continue? I was just filling in for you.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes. Now we can hear you. Yeah.
There is some issue with my internet.
Yeah, bandwidth is low. It happens. Don't worry about that. Just go ahead.
So there was certain policy regulatory uncertainty which impeded deployment of rooftop. But after recent MERC order, there is significant clarity about it. And my sense is now even the developers are seeing that clarity, and the rooftop deployment will really pick up in coming months. Immediately after the order, there was this whole COVID related uncertainty, so it was not picking up. But now my sense is it will pick up. There are no policy regulatory uncertainty. It's only a question of, you know, availability of roof space, which would be a limitation. Yeah.
Can I add on to that question, Shantanu? My understanding was that it's basically a lot of opposition from DISCOMs. Rooftops is equal to revenue leakage. And that is the main problem.
That's a good story idea. That rooftop equals revenue leakage. Rooftop means smart meters. Rooftop means that you start selling money, selling electricity.
Again, I missed some part, but based on whatever I understood, I think the question was about impact on distribution companies and their loss of revenue. But MERC has given a clear direction that until rooftop reaches 2000 megawatts, they will not charge any grid support charge. So up to that level, there is significant clarity. And beyond that, there will be some grid support charge, and that, you know, is like the cost that everybody will have to bear, you know, because that is the cost of cross subsidy. But as I mentioned, if we also have significant solarization of agriculture, the whole need for cross subsidy will reduce significantly. And that will also help address some of these revenue concerns of distribution companies. So one needs to have a very holistic approach to look at distribution company finances.
Right, thanks.
Sorry, very quickly, there are some nice examples from Pondicherry and Delhi of what do you do when you have shared rooftops or rented rooftops for residential. So, you know, sometimes the policy needs to be made a little flexible to allow for these possibilities as well. In Germany, they have this option of leasing rooftops. So someone else bears that huge upfront capital cost, sort of the residents can share in the benefits. Thanks,
Ulka. I think Vibhuti has an important point to make about the company.
Thanks,
viability.
People, yeah.
Yeah, Go ahead, Vibhuti.
No, just to add, I think from commercial economics, for CNI consumers, it's already a very attractive proposition to shift to solar rooftop, because they are paying very high grid tariffs. So even after imposition of any open access charges or additional grid support charges, it's still lucrative for them. And different organizations, as per their, as Ulka was pointing out, individual organizations have also committed to net zero carbon emissions. So most of them are, looking for this kind of options that can help them to, shift to more clean energy sources. So for CNI consumers, there has been a good offtake of solar rooftop, but for residential, apart from, awareness and issues and, for most of the consumers, given we are having such highly subsidized electricity tariff, so barring the big consumers, so big houses where the consumption levels are beyond, say 400 kilowatt hour or 500 kilowatt hours, for them, they are the only ones who are on their own converting, because they are paying high electricity tariffs to the grid. So for me, or at least most of the consumers, this issue boils down to cost economics. So if they feel that, there is an advantage and their capex will be paid back in few years, which ranges from 3 to 5 years in different state, depending upon the tariff they are paying. There are consumers who are opting for this. So yeah, it boils down to cost economics at the end of the day. And if there are policies that can help, because there is an upfront capital expenditure, which residential consumers struggle. So I think that's another reason for a slow offtake. But as I said, over time, they do realize there is a payback, and that kind of incentivize few consumers, but not everybody.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks. Right. Okay. We are 1 hour and 38 minutes into this workshop. That's very encouraging to see the level of how involved people are. But I also know that for many of my colleagues, we are going to hit deadlines pretty soon. So I'm going to ask the panelists if any of them want to have any concluding remarks. Ulka?
No, nothing really, just that we are there here to provide any data or explain, clarify anything at all. We are
That's a very generous offer. You will be mobbed. I can see that you will be mobbed. Yeah, Vibhuti.
No, likewise, if together we can create positive environment, and if that can lead the state to and the consumers to go for more renewable energy, we would be happy to share any data or any analysis that we undertake and help push the case for more renewable energy adoption.
Thank you. Shantanu.
Yeah, I think we are at a very exciting stage where renewable energy is really likely to, grow very significantly without causing any financial burden for consumers or the state government. And the question is going to be, how do we keep up this momentum? So we are always available, I'll be happy to answer any further queries on email, or journalists are also welcome to visit our website, where a lot of related information is made available. So happy to support any further work on this topic. Thank you.
Very good. Vandana, last word to you.
Yeah, just replicating and re-emphasizing what my predecessors have said, that most welcome for any data or any queries, whatever is possible. We will, at BNEF, we have a lot of data, and we'll be more than happy to share that with you. And also, as I said, on our website, if I was not working with BNEF, I would still be looking at that website, because a lot of themes that there are a lot of new themes that are coming up. I mean, last year, net zero was like a very remote concept, And now it's all about net zero, and companies are doing net zero or going carbon negative or climate positive. So happy to be part of the conversation and happy to help in any way we can.
So people, bnaf.com is the place to go to.
Yes, please.
Okay. Yeah, absolutely. Please do. Right. Okay. Now I can see there are more questions, but please, we are going to share all emails, all presentations. So take them up individually over email. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot to all the panelists. Thanks a lot to all the participants for your very active participation. Have a great day. Apply for those story grants and keep those stories coming. It's only when we push with stories that RE will move. Bye, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye. All the best.
Bye. Thank you. All the best.
Bye.